verse 6. I want you to zero on this verse. And let it be a rule or standard for whether or not you are properly fellowshipping with God. And 7. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the what? Now that verse is so clear that it's practical. If I say I have fellowship with God, and God is not in darkness, God is always in the what? But I'm walking in, I am not practicing truth, and I'm not in fellowship with the Lord. Now look at verse 7. But if we walk in the light, that's fellowship with God, as God is always in the light. If I'm gonna be what God is in. All right. Listen to the text now. We have fellowship with God. That ain't what the text said. The text says that when I'm walking with God, I am walking with you. I can't talk about how much I know him and don't want to walk with you. Can't talk about how much I love him and I don't want to love you. Because that is not what the text says. The text says, if I'm in the light, I will then have a fellowship with Bobby. Is that Bible? See what has happened to us? We've got so heavenly minded. We're no earthly good. We become professional Christians. We know how to shout hallelujah, but we don't know how to live it. And so we got folk talking about how much they love the Lord, can't stand the person they're next to. No, you don't love God. And John goes on to say that's just not so. When you are right with God, first between me and Luther could be wrong, but that is not the ultimate purpose of it. It could be that I've lost my connection. And if I lost my connection, I'm not just going to be wrong with Luther. I can't stand nobody. Everybody is against me. Nobody really understands how I feel. I don't understand none of them folk down there at the church, what they trying to do. Because I'm not walking in the light. And that's why I don't congregate regularly at the church. You ought to hear me. You really ought to hear me. And I keep finding myself moving further and further back. And after a while and by, I miss one Sunday. That was really difficult. But the next Sunday. And the next Sunday. Now I'm mad about, because nobody ain't called me, I'm going to miss the next Sunday. They haven't really missed me. What happened is you miss Jesus. Because you miss Jesus, you'll miss out on everybody else. God can't do nothing with you, we can't. Help me, somebody. Father, we bless you that your word is true. Speak to our hearts in clear and convincing ways and allow your word to be the final testimony of what we will say yes to. Thank you now. In Jesus' name, come on, say amen. All right, number one. This is a very short lesson. Number one, why is fellowship so important? I belong in God's family with other believers. You belong here. You ain't trying to carve your niche here. God has already carved your niche. He's already made a space for you. right here. You belong here. You're not second-class citizen in the body of Christ. Like what my dad used to say, there's no big eyes and no little U's. Everybody belongs here. Have I got a witness? And we've got to treat people like they belong. Whether you know them, get to know them. Help me, somebody. You know, we wouldn't even use the kind of excuses we use in the church if new people came in on the job. All the boss would have to do is give the directive, get to know them. Boop, we're out. Hi, my name is, you know, and we just get to know them. Get to know people around you. Look around and see how many people in Southeast you don't know. It's a lot of people you don't know. And they want to get to know you. And the value that God has placed and the deposits that God has made in me and in Luther, Stephen, in Wendell. Listen, I can't do without them. You really ought to hear me. We need each other. God has just placed some things in you that I need. He's placed some things in others that we need. And we need each other. And the reason my life goes depleted is because I'm not drawing the deposits out where God has placed them. I keep talking to heaven, but heaven keeps directing me to my brother. You really ought to hear me. And so I belong in the family of God. I got a place here. God has placed infinite worth in me. I matter here. I can do something in this church, and we may not be doing it right now, but there's something that you can do. Number two, I need encouragement. And you could, there's a scripture with that, of course. I need encouragement to grow spiritually. Let us think of one another and how we can encourage each other to love and do good deeds. I need encouragement. I need stimulation. I need motivation to stay on the battlefield for the Lord. If everybody is running away, throwing their rifles down, I'm more inclined to do the same. But I see people standing up for Jesus, walking the right way, talking the right way, I'm more inclined to do the same. That's what they call carpet culture. They don't have to necessarily tell you everything. You just go in there observing what they're doing. And whatever they're doing, you're more inclined to do the same. That says if I miss church on any whim, I'm leading others. You know, I got to tell folks, I don't think I'm coming back tonight. What about you? I'm leading others. I broke that this morning. What? You gonna show up because Pastor said show up? I'm leading others. When I encourage people that, you know, baby, I won't be here tonight, but I pray that things are going well. You ought to hear me. Number three, I need accountability to grow spiritually. People learn from one another just as iron sharpens iron. Accountability helps me. I don't know about you. You can use a whole lot of rope. Too much rope, I'll hang myself. Too much rope, I'll hang myself. So I give myself accountability. Measured accountability for me because I know better than you know. I said, I know me better than you know. But the same thing that's true about me is true about you. You know better than I know. I wish I had somebody. We ain't got to act pious. You know better than I know. Matter of fact, there's some things about you you ain't going to let me know. But I need accountability. Don't give me too much rope. You know, amen. Amen, amen, amen. God's word is true. But when we have accountability, it helps. It sharpens it. It gives us the ability to do what God wants us to do. Amen. Number four, Christ is present when we fellowship together. For wherever two or three have come together in my name, I am there right among them. Let me put a little bit more on that. Christ is there when we are talking about Christ.
Because everywhere believers are, they ain't talking about Jesus. I got to just put a little bit more mustard on that hot dog. Yeah, some folk getting together, they ain't talking about nothing that got anything to do with Christ. Help me, Holy Ghost. I'm talking about what Jesus is exalted. His name is glorified. His children are loved, prayed for, and cared for. There, the Lord says, I'll be with you. Amen. Amen. All right. Number five. There is power when people pray together. God Almighty. Man, there's so much power. I'm just a believer in prayer. And I encourage you to be a believer in instant prayer. The very moment you hear, let's pray. And don't. I'm gonna pray for you, baby. Quit telling that lie. We tell it all the time. I've done it before. Hey, man, I'm going to pray for you. And as soon as I walk out, forget the whole thing. The next time I see him, Reverend, you've been praying for me. Woo! You just got to hold your peace. Pray instantly. That's a good remedy. You know, look, folk going to do what they want to instantly. Walk up on you, you know, ask you, do you want to hit this blunt? You know, you want some of this reefer? You want some of this? That's instantly. They ain't gonna get you ready for it. They're gonna ask you for it. You want it right now. They gonna give you ungodliness instantly. Give them some godliness. Pray instantly. Turn on the light. Amen. And Christ is present. I tell you. Just pray. Don't let nobody fool you. It works all the time. All right, number five. There is power when people, I'm sorry. Yeah. Number six, I'm sorry. Fellowship is a witness to the world. My prayer, Jesus says, for all of them is that they will be of one heart and mind so the world, woo, will believe you sent me. Luther and Thurman ain't always fussing, talking about each other, smiling in each other's face. Luther going in one corner. That Reb ain't no good. Good. I'm going in another corner. You know that Luther ain't no good. Then every time, hey, Luther, what's happening? How you feel, man? Everything all right? You know me and you showing up tight. And people see that. And complain about that. How you keep going down to that church talking about the pastor. Every time I see you, you got something to say about the pastor and the preacher you sitting under. No, I ain't going to church with you. I don't even understand why you going. Making any sense? But that makes sense. I mean, we're losing our witness because we're not conscientious about what we are saying in our conversation with people who can observe us in the world. Number seven, I am obligated to every other Christian. God has given you special ability. Be sure to use them to help each other. There's nobody in this church that doesn't have abilities that can help someone else in this church. As long as you are breathing, God has designed for you to help somebody else. The very first assignment God gave man is to help somebody. Help somebody. Amen. And so you want to be involved in helping people. You want to be mindful that your place here at Southeast helps encourage others. Your smile, your handshake, your hello, your presence brightens up the room, brings joy when people see you here. It's a cold place when we know a whole lot of folk ought to be here, but a few of us are. Come on, say amen. Amen. So I'm obligated to encourage the body of Christ, and so therefore I'm coming to encourage them. Okay, the one another's a fellowship. Of course, these are just some of the one another's in the Bible. I think there's somewhere like 32, 33 one another's in the Bible. That God makes us clearly aware that we ought to be aware. Serve one another. Accept one another. There's some weak people, some unruly people. I mean, in the body, you know what I mean? You got to understand that. Serve, accept one another. Everybody ain't, you know, on the right track. We're trying to get some people on the right track. Some people are carnal in the church. And they're going to let you know when they open up their mouth, they carnal. Hear me well. Because that conversation does not become or is not equivalent to the gospel of Jesus Christ. What is that equivalent to? Carnality. Are you thinking with me? So we've got to accept some people, forgive one another. Why would we have to forgive one another, don't we? You know? Because you're human and I'm human. And where you put human beings, you will always have dilemma. We want to act as if, you know, just because folk are saved, everything is going to be all right. No, everything ain't all right. Everything ain't all right in our individual lives, and everything ain't all right, listen, in our institutional lives, where we come together. And forgiveness is a part of maintaining our relationship. Amen. Greet one another, bear one another's burden. Whatever burden Luther has, I get under it and help Luther to bear that burden, so I make it lighter for Luther. That's the text. Bear one another's burden. Be devoted. Be committed to one another. Honor one another. You know, see the value that's in Luther, not just see the value that's in me. Give Luther a seat, not just be about my seat. Luther needs a place to serve, not just my place to serve. Teach one another, submit to one another, encourage one another. How can a large church maintain close friendship? Every member needs to be a part of a small group. You know, we come to worship, and ain't nobody notice I was there. Ain't nobody notice a whole lot of people was there. You ain't the only one that went unnoticed. Amen. I mean, you know, I'm in a pulpit sometime. I might go unnoticed. People go unnoticed. You know, Pastor, you ain't see me? No, I didn't. You looking right at me. I was looking at you and over you. You know, you hear me talking, doesn't mean, you know, the Holy Spirit might be talking to you. You may think I'm talking to you, but you need to recognize the Spirit is talking to you. Well, I know you saw me because you was all over my feet. No, baby, I ain't see you. And sometimes, you know, your people think that, but it's, you know, you don't always see them. But you can be seen and heard and felt and known in a small group. And you should be. It should not be about just teaching. It should be about caring. People don't want to know how much you know. They want to know how much you care. Do you care? Yes, I care. Amen. Amen. God is good all the time. All right. So two types of church meetings and large meetings, like we're having General Assembly now, but we'll go back next week to our small groups. Next week we're going where? Back to our classes, our small groups. That should be a kind of, you know, I got to be careful when I say this. It should be kind of like a miniature church. Not disconnected from the church. But it should be a miniature church. Amen. That there are places directors are giving lay pastor leadership. Amen. Amen. And you are helping one another in that classroom. Amen. At Southeast, we believe our church must grow larger and smaller at the same time. How can we do that? We want people to be a part of small groups. And listen, we can do that by getting to know people. I'm amazed that, you know, people, you know, they pass right by people in the church. Go to other places, want to get to know everybody in the room. Hello, somebody. Get to know people. I mean, we ask, do you know everybody in the room? Some people might jump, yeah, you do. Then we say, okay, let's take that to a secondary and quaternary question. Start naming everybody on the first row and keep going. Yeah, uh-huh. Oh, well, you know, I get to know people. Get to know the church. You want the church to keep growing. I mean, all the pews, all the seats should be filled right now. But people are going to come in on the preaching and leave out on the relationship. Come in on the preaching. Reverend, that was good to me. I want to be a part of this church. But our not speaking, not getting to know, says to them, wait your turn. You don't want to say that. You want to say you are involved. And you can get involved on some level. Can you say amen? Amen. All right. Let's move on. What is the purpose of our small groups? Number one, we will do Bible study. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Acts chapter 2, verse, 42. They got in small groups. No church building. They went from house to house. Worked real good, too. And that biblical concept can work among us. You need to get in Bible study. Don't nobody hardly know me. Get in Bible study. Get in a church group. People can get to know you. I mean, you know, you'd be amazed how people are away from this church. You'd be amazed. Acting all shy. Get away from this church. Lord, have mercy. Is that Sister Soares? Baby, I didn't even recognize you. Amen. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about. Number two, fellowship. Let's have fellowship together. It develops the right relationship. Let's share in one another's lives. Fellowship is so important. I need it. You need it. You need to talk to somebody who really cares. You don't need no food for friends. You need somebody to tell you the real truth about where you are. You're in the wrong place, Reb. You need to pray about that. You know, you don't need to go off on it. You're going off on a deep end. You need that. I need that. You know, I say to my wife, tell me the truth. I need it. I say to some friend, man, just tell me the truth. Don't sugarcoat it. Get your act together. Thank you. If now and then you need it, amen. Let me know you say, yeah. I know some of y'all saying, yeah, Pastor, you need it. Number three. Communion, breaking bread. It's nothing like when you break bread together, people put their feet under your table. In the Old Testament day, that was an indication of a relationship. They came to the table with you. You wanted to have a relationship with them. You invite somebody home to dinner. That's an indication of a relationship. Now, I'm not talking about, you know, getting all lovey-dovey. That's indicating of a relationship. Amen. And we ought to be developing in the body of Christ relationships. So there's Bible study, there's fellowship, there's communion. And number four, you see in Acts chapter 2, there's prayer. We ought to be praying for one another and to pray. So we get in our small groups on Sunday morning and we pray. We get in small groups in different areas of the church. Of course, you have praise dances. They pray when they have praise dances. Other little small groups. Women ministry ought to be praying when they come together. Men's ministry ought to be prayer when you come together. All of these things affect your life in the church. Amen. Number five, support. They gave to one another as they had a need. We ought to support people. We ain't always got to wait till Sunday. Sunday might not wait. The money is in your pocket. Pull it out. Show some support. I say it all the time. If there's a need in your Sunday school class, show some support for that person in your Sunday. Now, listen. Don't nobody know anything about no silent need. I had a need. Ain't nobody did nothing for me. Did nobody know you had a need? Too insecure to say you had one. People who are normal can identify their needs. I got needs, you know. I mean, you have to identify those needs. You don't, you're going to be maladjusted. I hope I'm helping somebody. You can't talk about, you know, you hungry, you don't want to eat. That's something messed up with that. When you're not eating, your child ain't eating, you know they is sick. Amen? So when you identify your needs, that's normal. Touch your neighbor and say, when you identify your needs, that's normal. When you hide your needs, that's abnormal. Everybody clear on that? Amen. Amen. You need to tell your husband what your needs are. Tell your wife what your needs are. Somebody say, stop teasing, Pastor. It's normal. All right, number six. All right, they ate together, so that's social. We come together in a social way, yet the spiritual emphasis is there. In other words, we make contact. We see each other. They ate together with gladness and sincere hearts. Number seven, I got to move a little faster. We almost finished. They came together and praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Listen, you don't need nobody to tickle your spine to say hallelujah. You need to learn to open up your mouth and bless the Lord. David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. I don't need nobody to give me a bonus to bless his name. You don't need that. You know, that's what we're waiting on. Some check to come in the mail. Whoo, the Lord has blessed me. Thank you. Everybody know you got a check. When it ought to be every time we come in God's house, I will make a joyful noise unto the Lord. You know, for one, baby, you got a check this week? No, honey. The Lord's my lottery. You really ought to hear me. Some of us are really on that equilibrium swing. You know, we got money, we have, we don't have money. Oh, Lord. The joy of the Lord. You'll practice it right now. And then you'll see how God begins to develop it in your life. Practice it right now, because you got to be careful now, because, you know, we our emotions go like the weight of our pockets. Amen. Number eight, outreach. Now, they met in small groups, and the Lord did what? Added. The Lord did what? I can't add. The Lord did what? God adds to the church, and you are not subtract. God adds to the church, and you are not subtract. It's a blessing. When you walk in here, see, this year, 117. Because the Lord added this morning. And you should not subtract. 117 and count. You ought to be happy about that. You ought to be excited about that. That God is adding to the church. That there's one more voice to lift up that name, Jesus. And that's one more person to join in this prayer. You ought to be excited about that. That's something God is doing. Now, some folks look and see it as some thermos doing. I ain't doing nothing. God's doing it. And it's something for all of us to jump and shout. Yeah, man. You don't have to do it. Maybe I ought to just go on and say it. Because a whole lot of churches are closing this morning. Some of y'all don't believe that, do you? They're closing this morning. They haven't had one this year added. And God is adding. And when God is adding, it ought to change your attitude. Now that ought to change your attitude. Some of us want to add to the pocket and not to his house. But when he's adding, your attitude ought to be enthusiastic, because it evidences his presence. And I want to be where God, I know I want to be. My life is short. Just yesterday I was, you know, just getting out of school, but it was a long time ago. Amen. All right. How to start and maintain good habits. Number one, we talked about them. You have to have the desire. I got to have the desire for the word of God. I got to have a desire for prayer. I have to have the desire to give. God starts with your desire. It's amazing that some people don't even have a desire to give. They let this little, you know, if you ever go to U.S. Mint, that money you got in your pocket, You know what they do with that stuff? They shred it. People killing over shredded paper. I mean, they are taking lives over. The highest capital you got, look in the mirror. Some of y'all ain't gonna hear me. Other culture and kind gonna tell you. Highest capital you got, just look in the mirror. God has invested infinite worth in you. There is no money on earth. All the money on earth is not more valuable than. You ought to hear me. Think DuPont shot somebody, took him to jail. All the money on earth is. We let that little bit of money come between me and the Lord. Just have a desire. That's all it starts. Fellowship starts with a what? Desire. And when I'm not in the word, when I'm not in prayer, when I'm not in fellowship, when I'm not giving, maybe my desire. Lord have mercy. It's been burnt out and God needs to build it back in. Number two, decide. Make a decision. Always make a commitment. If it's something worth having, make a commitment. I'm over my time. Number three, make a declaration. I will do it. Come on, write faster. Number four, make a determination. It takes 7 to 21 repetitions to learn something. Repetition is the mother of learning. Always be repetitious about what you want to learn. Go over and over and over and over whatever you're trying to learn. That's how people learn. They go over and over and over and over. They regurgitate, go over and over and over. Number five, just do it. Just do it. Just pray. Just fellowship. Just read your Bible. Just give. Just do it. Start somewhere. I'm always amazed. People just will not do it. Number six, double up. Do it again. Do it again. Do it again. Take it a little bit higher. Increase it. Increase your Bible study. Increase your prayer life. Increase your fellowship. Whenever you can. Amen. Number seven, depend on God for it all. Depend on God for it all. Depend on God. They may be filling it in on the screen. You don't get the answers, they will give you the answers. You don't get the lessons, they will give you the lessons. You call, we don't get it to you the next day. Don't get upset. The printer has some ink in it. Amen. And we can get it all to you. I'm going to give this to Cedric. Now, let me say, now, next week we're going back to our classes. I think I made the statement to the teachers on Friday night. If every member in Southeast would come, I could give my right hand for it. Just because it's just that important. And let's just say that's a hyperbole. But you ought to know from that statement, it's important that you be in Sunday school. You carry them, you drag them, you will them in. You say you're gonna have to work this time around. But you'll learn something about yourself. You'll learn something about what you can do, where God wants to plug you in the body of Christ. We don't have the ministry. We'll create the ministry. Don't be afraid. Take some chance here. Stretch yourself a little bit. Get in those Sunday school rooms. Get your lesson. Don't lose it. Bring it back the next Sunday. Let's do it a different way and see what God will do. You'll discover your spiritual gift. You'll discover your heart. You'll discover your abilities. You'll discover your personality. You'll know that God can use your experience. I'm telling you. If you trusted me on anything, trust me on this. Take these 8 weeks. Get in Sunday school. Call everybody you can. We're going to get it. You're going to say, Pastor, no, I'm telling you. I can't tell you like I feel it. I can only say it to you. I can always say to you, you got to go with the going. But I wish everybody would go. Like I wish everybody would go to heaven. You know, this will revolutionize your life. You'll understand yourself better. And you can talk to me, you can call me, you can ask me any kind of questions, ask the teachers any kind of questions, but if you just got to call me, call me. Say, Pastor, what do you think my personality is? Where do you think my heart is? How best can I use my experiences? It will bless your life. Thank you.
I hope the days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you wanted, till your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same thing. But you never forget all the ones who love you and the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret.